Sterling Properties of Santa Barbara proudly presents Ken Boxer Live. From the American Riviera in Santa Barbara, California, it's Ken Boxer Live with your host, Ken Boxer, and co-host, two-time Olympian Tai Babilonia. Please welcome Ken and Tai.
Thank you so very much.
Thank you.
Wow, what a crowd. Thank you. Thank you. I'm Ken Boxer, and you're watching Ken Boxer Live. As always, I always introduce my lovely and talented co-host, not only the two-time Olympian, as mentioned, but she's also five-time national champion, as well as a world champion Olympic figure skater, Tai Babilonia.
Thank you, Ken. Well, thank you.
Great to be back. Tell me something.
Tell
me about how excited we are about this
show. Beyond excited. If you've been on Facebook, I've been raving. I've been tweeting and Facebooking about our guest tonight. Olympic champion Rafer Johnson is with us.
Yes.
We are honored to have him in the studio. Rafer has taught me really about paying it forward with his work with Special Olympics and just, you know, giving back. And I can't thank him enough for that. So, with saying that, we'll be right back with Rafer Johnson.
Let's get started. Don't go away. All right.
Ken Boxer Live, brought to you in part by the Wildcat Lounge, repeatedly voted Santa Barbara's best dance club. The Eagle Inn, a family-owned hotel near the beach in Santa Barbara. And by American Riviera Bank. Feel good about your bank. Now back to Ken Boxer Live.
Thank you so very much. Yeah. And we are back. Now, let's welcome the two-time Olympic decathlon gold and silver medalist and the Pan American Games gold medalist and founding member of the California Special Olympics and former actor, the truly amazing Rafer Johnson. Welcome to our show.
Thank you. Thank you.
Bravo.
Very pleased to be here.
How did you first meet? I'm curious. How did you and Tai get together?
Good question.
Probably some Olympic event.
Right. We do.
In the Valley.
Yeah. You know, probably back in the 80s. But, you know, it could have been a Special Olympics event. But you are really the first person to say, this is a great organization, and start giving back. So, Rafer, thank you for that.
Well, thank you.
Yeah. So wonderful.
Thank you very much. Yeah.
Rafer, your career has been vast, and I wanted to find out, looking back on your career, what is in sports your biggest accomplishment in sports for you?
Well, there are several, actually. I think having the opportunity to go to UCLA and compete in the athletic program there, track and field, and also I played 3 years for Coach John Wooden. And I think that any young man in this case who has the chance to play, you know, possibly with the greatest coach ever, I look back on that with very fond memories. But the whole idea that I had the opportunity through sports to be the best that I could be, as all Olympians think.
I know we have two Olympians in this room.
Yeah.
It's amazing.
I love being with Tai, and I love what she brought to her sport.
Thank
She was the best that was competing, and she continued to give something back to the community, and I think that that part of it interests me a great deal. I don't think that there are any champions, I certainly wasn't one, who thought that I could be the best I could be with just my own talents and my own thoughts. But I had my coaches, my family, my friends who supported me. And I just have used all these opportunities, Special Olympics, working with young people, with opportunity and the chance to give something back, because that's how I made it through all these things that I've been a part of.
Well, you brought a clip with you, and we can show our audience. The first clip is about something you were seeing some of your competition when you won the 1960 gold medal in the decathlon.
Yeah, thank you.
I love this.
Can you set us up what we're about to see?
Well, the 60 games, I had the opportunity to work with CK Young, Chong Kwang Young from Taiwan. And we were teammates at UCLA for 4 years prior to those games. We were together in 1956 in Melbourne, and CK didn't really have a great finish there, and I won a silver medal, and that's not where I train. I mean, I appreciated it, but I worked out to be, you know, I wanted to win the gold. So I had the opportunity to come back 4 years later against CK. And by the way, CK beat me in 7 of the 10 events, and this is 2 of those events that we participated in.
Okay, let's watch. Watch the monitor, people at home, let's watch.
First of all, what was your training schedule like for the games, leading up to the games?
Well,
what was a day like?
Well, it's almost like any other sport or competitive event. I had a program that I worked on. Every 3 days, I would go through the 10 events in the decathlon.
Okay.
And then I'd just start all over again, and that process continued all the way up and through the Olympic Games.
Right.
CK, 3 of those events that we just saw, he beat me in those 3. But I beat him in the javelin,
right,
the shot put, and the discus. Now, you don't have to win every event in the decathlon. If you need to finish high.
Right.
But the further you jump, the faster you run,
absolutely,
the more points you get. And he beat me like a half inch in the long jump and a tenth of a second in the hurdles. But I beat him pretty soundly in the shot, discus, and javelin.
But how come, if you think back on decathletes, the famous ones, you're very famous from your sport, Bruce Jenner. Those two come to mind.
Right.
But why haven't the others? Most people probably wouldn't even know who won or who represented the United States in the decathlon in the last few Olympics. Why
well,
is that?
You're right. Well, Bob Mathias was a very special individual. As well as an athlete. He won the decathlon in both in 1948 in Helsinki and 52 and in London, and was very popular throughout the world.
Yes.
I mean, he was the first athlete in this event to win it 2 games in a row. So that brought some notoriety to the event and some interest on the part of young people around the world, and I was one of them. I lived 20 miles north of Bob Mathias and from in Tulare, California. I lived in Kingsburg. So he brought that, and then CK and I came along, and I said we were classmates together. We worked out together. We were both elected captains of our respective teams, he Taiwan and me the United States. We were both flag bearers. And both carried the flag.
I didn't know that.
And so now we had the duel. And he was an unbelievable athlete. And it ends up, again, that surprised by some people, but not necessarily by me, because he was a great athlete and beat me in 7 of the 10. And so that added something to it. And I ended up winning that Olympic Games by less than 100 points, which is very close. It's like
most people don't know that.
No, no, that's
it's very
a nice
close.
You won the gold. That's all that.
Yeah,
but there's a story. There's a story I want you to share because it's a great story, and it happened in your training. You were training at UCLA,
right?
And Kirk Douglas was on the track, and take it. Such a
yeah,
great
well,
story.
In those days we had amateurs and
yes,
pros,
mm-hmm,
and the AAU Amateur Athletic Union said to me that I couldn't do anything that I was using my notoriety from track and field for to make income from.
Right.
And Kirk Douglas worked out on the track, as did many, you know, several Hollywood actors and actresses. And he had this film coming out called Spartacus. And so I tried out for it and won the part. So then the AAU says, well, you're not an actor. How is it that you got the part? I said, well, I was in my high school play. I did community theater.
I love that.
And they said, no, it doesn't work. So they said to me, either you can do one of two things. You can do the movie, and then you can't go to the Olympics, because they made a very definite line between pro and amateur, which is not so true today. You can do those kinds of things and make it work. But so I chose the Olympics.
Speaking of Olympics, how did it come about that you became the torchbearer, that you lit the torch in the 1984 Olympics? How did you get that honor? What was the phone call or letter?
I was on the board of directors, and again, trying to give something back. I was a board member who worked like everybody else, hoping the games would be successful, and obviously got to know Peter Ueberroth quite well. Right. I'm going to tell you a very quick story. Peter's in the office, in the audience sometimes, and says, "I don't know about that." But when I was on the executive committee, there were 25 of us on that committee. And so one day I walked in, and there were only two other board members coming in after me, so I sat down at the seat right next to me. And when the other two came in, they decided that we'd have enough discussion about who was going to be the actual president and run the games. And Peter Ueberroth, of course, was the one that came out in the votes.
Right.
And it just so happened, the seat that I sat in, I cast, it was 12-12 when it got to me, and I cast the final vote for Peter Ueberroth, and guess who carried the torch?
Oh, my God.
Yeah, for
great
the
story. Great story.
In fact,
we have footage
of that, so let's go to that right now. We can all get the goosebumps watching it and relive this moment.
How many steps?
Right. Magical.
100 steps straight
100
up.
Steps.
Okay, let's watch Rafer Johnson. Olympian Rafer Johnson.
Those were the best Olympics.
They were probably the greatest Olympic Games ever held.
I heard that Bruce Jenner was actually kind of your backup, just in case something would happen if you couldn't make it up those 100 steps.
Yes, he was. We had a rehearsal, and I actually made it up those stairs a couple of times, but the third time I got cramps. So Bruce was in the group carrying the Olympic flag. And so I guess they made some kind of deal that if I staggered along the way, Bruce was going to come up and, you know, he had a Velcroed outfit on, and he was going to rip it off and have the
like a stunt. He was like a stunt double.
And he was going to go up further. And when I realized it was Bruce Jenner, there was no way I was
going
to do that.
Yeah.
No way.
Rafer.
That's great.
Rafer, our audience may not know this, but in 1957, you were Sports Illustrated Sportsman of the Year. Congratulations on that. It's a great honor and a title. But who do you think, in your lifetime, was the greatest athlete that you would recognize to be that in that category?
You know,
can you do that?
Someone like Jesse Owens. I mean, Jesse Owens was an unbelievable athlete. You might remember that on a single afternoon, he set three world records. I think maybe four, including the relay. And his Olympic performance in Germany was in 36 was like one of the great performances ever in sports. I mean, you could go to different sports and there'd be a great athlete.
Tai.
But I think, you know, I think, yeah, actually, and you know, and Jim Thorpe.
Sure.
I mean, he's the one name that you would hear up front more often than not.
And Bruce.
Well, yes. For sure.
Okay.
But you know Bob Mathias.
Yeah.
Bob Mathias. I mean, Bob Mathias was an unbelievable guy. He was in high school when he won the first decathlon, 17 years old. He didn't know anything about half the events. I don't think he'd ever thrown the javelin.
Really?
Yes. And he won the games and came back and won them a second time. So, I mean, there's so many athletes you could put in the mix.
Wilma Rudolph?
Wilma Rudolph was unbelievable.
Yes.
She and one of the
of
great
course,
performers.
In track and field, Bob Beeman. You can't throw him out for that.
Yeah,
right.
Yeah,
had
you
a,
could. We could. We could go on all night here.
That's
with,
a whole
with,
other show.
With people
right.
Who really were excellent at what they
right.
they did, and they did it at a time when they had to do it. I mean, it wasn't some off somewhere in the distance where nobody knew about it. I mean,
right.
they were right there in the front of millions of people, and that's a pretty tough task.
And you're also, as I mentioned in the introduction, one of the founders of the Special Olympics here in California.
Yes
I had the pleasure of working with Mrs. Shriver when she was putting this idea together about
right.
Special Olympics, and she invited some of her friends back to Maryland, where in her backyard we talked to her about the events that we individually did, and to maybe help her get a little more information on the events. And the first International Games was in Chicago in 1968, and from that point forward you knew that they were going to be very successful because they had this driving force of Eunice Kennedy Shriver. Mm-hmm. And so because I was there and I was from California, I mean, I get a lot of credit. I won't accept it for starting the Special Olympics, but she said, you take it back to California. And other people took it back to their states, and we're named founders for those different states we went back to.
And isn't there a meet that's coming up? Is there
the Olympic? LA Games?
Yeah, big time.
What month do they start?
The games start on July 25th.
Okay.
And they run through August 5th. And this is going to be a great games. We're going to have 7,000 athletes mm-hmm. from 170 countries. Some 3,000 coaches, 30,000, we'll have more than 30,000, but 30,000 volunteers. And this is going to really be a showcase mm-hmm. for what Special Olympics is all about.
Yes.
Men and women and boys and girls with mental disorders will have an opportunity to be the best they can be. And that's what it's all about. Mrs. Shriver thought that every citizen in this country, particularly those with disabilities, mm-hmm. should have the opportunity to be the best they can be. And the goal, the thing that thrills me the most is to see an athlete participate in a meet like mm-hmm. these international games and are proud of their performance, and many of them, most of them, are the best they can be, and that's what we were all about as well.
It's right. the best, and it's as simple as giving a hug. You know, say they come and through the finish line, they just want a hug. I mean, it's so simple, but so effective, and Rafer, you're the one who introduced me to that.
Well, and
congratulations.
Thank you.
Also, what I want to mention is, because time's running out.
I know.
It goes too quickly. And it kind of ties in with the Kennedy clan. You were a hero. People label you not only a hero in athletics, but you were a hero on the day in June in 1968. You were there when Bobby Kennedy was
yes.
assassinated. And we'll talk about what you did and played in that. But let's go to the event of the assassination that day in that he had just won the primary, if I believe, in 1968.
Yes.
And you
at
were
the
there.
Ambassador.
But let's go back in time for just a moment, and then we'll address that, what happened that night.
Sure.
Let's watch the Bobby Kennedy right now.
So my thanks to all of you, and now it's on to Chicago, and let's win there. Thank you.
Since like Robert Kennedy has been shot.
Where was Eunice?
Ethel was the wife.
Yeah.
Well, I was with her at the as we went in through the kitchen. We were supposed to have stepped off the stage and gone out through the hall. But for some reason, they decided to go through the kitchen, which was a shorter way.
Right.
And as I walked into that area, I was with Mrs. Kennedy, and I heard what I thought were balloons popping. Well, it turns out I look across the room, and I see smoke coming from a gun. And I don't know, you know, what kind of gets into us. And so I made my way towards the gun.
Wait, while other people are scrambling, running away, you're going to the gun.
Well, it's interesting. You know, probably if I'd have been next to the gun, I'd probably fall away.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, probably. But I was so far away that I could see everything going on. And so I made the move.
And what did you do?
Well, I was the first one there, and I put my hand on the gun hand. And shortly after I arrived, Roosevelt Grier came, grabbed my hand, and we both, all three fell to the floor. And I'll tell you, Roosevelt Grier is like having a piano fall on you. And I wasn't going anywhere, and neither were Sirhan. So I eventually, and you know, he was in trouble there, and you know, we asked the people not to kick him. And so I eventually asked Rosie to let my hand go, and then when we did, then we had to literally peel Sirhan away from the gun. And I took the gun and put it in my pocket and went through the thing. The police came and did everything they did. The senator went off to the hospital. I went up for a few minutes afterwards and sat with the family. And then I was lived near there, so I went home and did a little sleep. Was coming right back, and I woke up. And I put my jacket, went to put my jacket on, and I noticed it was kind of heavy on one side.
Whoa.
And I had the I had the gun in my pocket. So I called I called the police, and they came, picked me up, and took me to the station where I turned the gun over. And that gun, of course, was used as the evidence against Sirhan. But
that's intense.
I don't know why I did that, but that's
just
that's what happened.
Beyond.
And
so,
of course, we were. Tai asked me if that's hard to watch. It is hard to watch, but we all had an unbelievable experience working with Robert Kennedy. And
yes.
We know that if he had lived, things would have been different, a lot different from the way we lived the political world and as American citizens subsequent to that assassination.
Do you ever relive that and say, God, if I could have just, you know, had Bobby Kennedy walk this way instead of going through the kitchen?
That's in some ways, but the Kennedys never, you never saw with them a lot of security. They just kind of wanted to be next to the people, and they didn't want anything in between them and the people. So that was the way they lived, and the people loved them. And I wish we had the pleasure of his presidency for at least 4 years, maybe more.
Yeah.
Sure. I'm staring at you, and I'm in awe that you're here and as our guest. But I'm looking at you, and can I ask your age?
No.
That was the best answer. That's what you get.
I'm 80 years old.
Yeah.
Ladies and gentlemen, I am like about 3 feet from Rafer, and you do not.
No.
There's no way you.
Well, he works out.
You look
every
in your 50s. Wow. Now, when you were in the Olympics, going up the stairs to light the torch, you were in your 50s, I imagine, right? Somewhere in that.
Yeah, 30s.
30s.
Late 30s. Late early 40s.
Early 40s. Okay.
Yeah.
But you look exactly the same.
He looks amazing.
Well, I comb my hair the same.
You look great.
We got to get going. It went by. We got just a few seconds. Another time. Will you come back?
Yes.
Well,
time
I will. I just want to tell the two of you, it's really a pleasure to be here with you tonight.
Thank you. Well, that's our show for tonight. Now, be sure to tune into our next show, as we'll be joined by actor Tony Dow. Tony, of course, is best known for his iconic role as Wally Cleaver from the hit television series Leave It to Beaver. Okay, that's our show for tonight. So for our guest, Rafer Johnson, and for my co-host, Tai Babilonia, and of course, our director, George Montalvo, and for the entire KBL crew, I'm Ken Boxer. Good night, everybody.
Ken Boxer Live is brought to you by the following sponsors. Sterling Properties of Santa Barbara, hometown feel, world-class service. American Riviera Bank, feel good about your bank. Palazzo Restaurant, where people don't leave hungry or thirsty. The Wildcat Lounge, repeatedly voted Santa Barbara's best dance club. Harbor View Inn, welcome to Santa Barbara's premier four diamond luxury boutique oceanfront hotel. Wendy Foster, Santa Barbara and Montecito's premier clothing store. The Eagle Inn, a family-owned hotel near the beach in Santa Barbara. Via Rosa Inn, let us pamper you in international style. And by Taffy's Pizza, delivery, pickup, or dine-in. Woody's Bodacious Barbecue, voted best barbecue in Santa Barbara for over 30 years. Santa Barbara Chicken Ranch, authentic Mexican style, mesquite barbecue. Los Arroyos Mexican Restaurant, takeout. Santa Barbara Bar, finally, nutritious tastes great. Country Catering, Meat Market and Deli. Their food not only fills your plate, it nourishes the soul. Jack's Bagels and Bistro, serving the very best food in a friendly and relaxed atmosphere. Sammy's Camera, new location at 530 State Street. Summer Lee, makeup artist, stylist, and esthetician. Perfect Computers, since 1990. The Ken Boxer Live musical theme by Mr. Michael J. Leslie. From all of us at Ken Boxer Live, I'm Darren Ron Heron. Good night, everyone.